Welcome to the Heinrich Böll Foundation. As you know, it's an English-only evening, so I switched to English right away. I'm here to say hello to you in the name of the Böll Foundation and also in the name, Uli Schreiber is here, of the International Literature Festival that invited for this evening with Breiten Breitenbach. We are very happy that you came to Berlin another time, that we're especially happy that you're here at the Böll Foundation. And we're very happy to see you all. As you saw, there was a very warm greeting already. So there's many friends of Breiten here tonight. And I'm sure we have an interesting evening. So having said so, I would also really like to welcome Priya Basel, who is an outstanding author herself, a writer, born in Kenya, grown up in Kenya, having lived 13 years in Berlin now, in Germany, previously in London, having spent enormous time in Europe, therefore she's very, very well equipped to lead the talk with Breiten tonight. She will introduce him properly, and then we will hear first Breiten's perspective on Europe, and then we will have a talk, and at the end also with you. So thank you for coming, and enjoy the evening.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you. Just add my thanks to Kirsten that you're all here this evening. It's my pleasure to introduce Breiten Breitenbach. To be an African is not a choice, it is a condition, Breiten Breitenbach has written. To be an African is not through lack of being integrated in Europe, neither is it from regret of the crimes perpetrated by my people. No, it is simply the only opening I have for making use of all my sense and capabilities. The African earth was the first to speak. I have been pronounced once and for all. Breiten Breitenbach was born in Bonneville, South Africa in 1939, the third of four children. Like many Afrikaner boys, he and his brothers were expected to become soldiers, farmers, or preachers, and to help maintain the apartheid status quo. Breitenbach struck out on another path when he registered at the University of Cape Town's Michaelis School of Fine Art. The impulse to write was as strong as the one to paint, and Breitenbach's poems first appeared in the student newspaper Grote Schuur in 1959. A few years later, without saying a word to his family, he left South Africa for Europe on a Portuguese steamer. That act may have been his first, most explicit expression of a primal impulse he would later describe as the urge to get up and go, to travel, to follow the beckoning horizon, to leave oneself behind and thereby approach inner silences and spaces. Like many aspiring young painters, Breiten Breitenbach ended up in France. There he met and married Yolande Ngoti Huang Lien, a woman of Vietnamese origin. This left him in contravention of the South African Prohibition of Mixed Marriages Act, so he was unable to return to his homeland. He remained in Paris, becoming an anti-apartheid activist in exile, as well as a Zen Buddhist. All the while, he kept writing and painting and began receiving critical acclaim for his work. In 1975, Breiten Breitenbach returned to South Africa using a false passport in the name of Christian Galaska, a French citizen. His mission was to set up a network of supporters for Okela, a resistance group he'd helped to found in exile. He was betrayed, caught by the police, and sentenced under the Terrorism Act to 9 years in prison, of which he served seven. He kept writing throughout his incarceration, handing over his pens and papers to the prison wardens at the end of each day. He remembers, he says, working on longer texts, prose texts, and having to hand it in and not getting it back, and then writing, continuing to write the next day without being able to read what you've written before. Perhaps this strange tutoring in working with fragments helped to shape the imagination that would go on to display an inventive boldness with form, mixing poetry and prose, memoir and fiction, painting and philosophy. In the decades since his release from prison, Breitenbach has written more than 30 volumes of poetry, several novels, a renowned four-volume memoir, short stories, essays and plays. His work has been widely translated, garnering accolades and prizes across the world. He received a French passport, a genuine one, in the 1980s, but kept his South African citizenship. He's the director of the Gori Institute, a center for democracy, development and culture in Africa based in Dakar, Senegal. He's taught as a professor at the University of Cape Town and New York University. All the while, he's remained an outspoken critic of political and moral failings in his home country and abroad. This engagement too, it seems, is not a choice, it is a condition. Writing in the New York Times Book Review, he reflected, "Man lives through and in man. The writer, the artist, who closes his eyes to everyday injustice and inhumanity, will, without fail, see less with his writing or painting eyes too. His work will become barren. When one prefers not to see certain things, when one chooses not to hear certain voices, when one's tongue is used only to justify this choice, then the things one turned away from do not cease to exist. The voices do not stop shouting, but one's eyes become walled, one's ears less sensitive, therefore deaf. One's tongue will make some decadent clacking noises, and one's hands will only be groping over oneself." Since that first major voyage on the Portuguese steamer, Brighton Breitenbach has kept on traveling, physically and imaginatively, reaching, seeking beyond oneself. This adventure involves, amongst other things, the continual discovery of other selves, the many strands of being that form each of us. His work has often affirmed this multiplicity. Some of his own myriad personas have been baptized in poetry: Bullebach, Buffalo Bill, Brouwer Bebe, Bangai Bird, all those double B's, a variation on the initials of his birth name. He's also published under pseudonyms, including Jan Blom. Tonight, he's here in a special capacity. He's here, according to the title of his talk, as an outsider looking in. And we're all very curious about the view. It's my pleasure to invite you to speak to us now, Brighton.
Thank you, Priya. It sounded such a nice story, I could have listened much longer. Thank you. And thank you for inviting me. Thank you for being here. It's good to see some familiar faces from all those many years ago. Klaas van der Roop, Hans-Christoph Buch, and Susan Eyman, and there must be some more people here whom I've known over the years. It's good to be back. The topic of tonight, Vreemde Europa, Strange Europe, I suppose in a sense it has already been worn so smooth over such a long period, we are worrying about it for so long, that I'm not sure that I can give anything original or a view that would come to you as anything original. I'm sure that many of you here worry this bone all the time. I remember from some of the conversations we had many years ago here in Berlin, when already this entity of Europe that was coming into being and how it was positioning itself to the rest of the world and what it meant to the rest of the world and how people coming from elsewhere reacted to this part of the world was already a subject of discussion, long discussions. I've organized what I have to say in a number of paragraphs, and as I go on, I'm less and less sure of, I'm less and less certain of what I have to say. So, as I say in my opening paragraph, please bear with me if it's done in a fragmentary way. I will try and explain my thoughts on the subject, perhaps a little bit more in detail once we enter into the discussion, and I hope you will take part in that. You will also notice that there's a kind of a deliberate simplification and even to some extent a provocation involved. It is of course done on purpose because I think given the time constraints and given the vastness of the subject, it's impossible to be too subtle or to go into the nuances, but I hope we will get there as well. So, I called it An Outsider Looks In, or Further Notes from the Middle World. And I start with a quote from a little book that I enjoyed immensely, written by a Greek writer called Nikos Dimou. It's called Über das Unglück eine Grieche zu sein. Eine Kurtis. Und doch ist das Lachen vielleicht der einzige Beweis menschlicher Freiheit. Unfortunately, the quote doesn't go much further than that. At least, I'm not going to try and use it too much. So, one, please bear with me when I propose my thoughts and reflections in a fragmentary way. In the world we live in, with its rapid evolution in modes of production, its exponential demographic explosion with a concomitant increase in a percentage of people who will never find work, and ever less water and food for the poor, with inadequate educational systems, with wars and epidemics, and the resultant population displacements, so that huge numbers of migrants roam the earth in search of survival. In the absence of effective international solidarity, a world where, other than global capitalism and fundamentalist Islamism, there's no longer a coherent eschatology or a worldview, perhaps simplistic, allowing for the greater potential of a moral imagination to develop, where we seem to have no defense against the arbitrary rule of a caste of politicians and bureaucrats and the power abuse and corruption, in a world enclosed by narcissism presented as personal liberation and self-fulfillment, by social decay and depression, a world becomes slippery with political correctness, which is nothing but moralistic intolerance masquerading as deference for the private space and pain of the other. A world where cynicism in the guise of a Putin or an Erdogan or a Netanyahu or an Assad or a Donald Trump or a Zuma passes for realpolitik, on a planet that we, its inhabitants, are destroying in an orgy of greed and self-indulgent consumerism. In such a world, and at times like these, it would be presumptuous and misleading to pretend to an integrated analysis or a coherent synthesis and discourse. We will leave such a conceit to the preachers and the prophets, the charlatan politicians, the spy masters, the bankers, the rabble-rousers, the statisticians, the television donkeys. I also plead, this is my second paragraph, I also plead your indulgence for being personal in my reading. Maybe I'm generalizing my own confusion, and what we experience ought rather to be ascribed to historical determinism, to the internal contradictions of a world profit system which can be understood and interpreted. After all, what we are witnessing is also the vicious thrashing of Western colonialism, bolstered by world capitalism attempting to secure its plunder, and then the reactions to that system of oppression and exploitation. But I can only use my own trajectory as conduit, better than to proceed from picture to picture, from day to day, and maybe from question to question. The quintessentially European attempts by Enlightenment to bring about rationality in human affairs have long since been instrumentalized by power to promote the darkness within which it can flourish in the coils of which we flounder. Reason falls short and may even be a trap. But I've spent enough time writing, attempting to impose a sequentiality on this process of dialectical interaction between the living matter of language, the outside, and inside the broken line of becoming conscious, to know that patterns do emerge and that these may approximate meaning. And some illustrations, three, of the thrashing as of beheaded chickens, of whom tens of thousands have now come home to roost. Recently, I saw an appalling series of documentary films detailing the continuation of colonialism in practice. The first one showed mostly young illegal miners in Burkina Faso, digging like moles and often dying in their holes for gold that, if found in a pan washed pebbles, will earn them perhaps €1 a day each, the gold that will be hoarded as ostentatious richness by people far away who couldn't care less where it came from. The young miners are doped on a mix of cocaine and prescription medicine, no longer valid for consumption in the countries of origin, dumped on Africa. And of course, one wonders who produced these drugs. The second film showed how bales of fripe, Fripe is the French word from the Latin falupa, meaning fiber or little thing without worth. Secondhand clothing, probably discarded to be collected and donated by various instances in France, ending up in Senegal to be traded commercially, where it will change local fashions and destroy the fabrication of indigenous cloth. A case of jobs scrounged from the cast-off excesses of the West, destroying local creativity. The third example showed how frozen chickens of inferior quality from France, meant only for Africa, massively flood the local market in Cotonou, to the extent that home producers must now freeze their chickens and offer them wrapped as if imported in order to sell them. I'm told that chickens never to be found on American dining tables are similarly exported in bulk to Africa. Now, these are some isolated examples of the nexus of dysfunctioning that lead to one end of the problem. Thousands of valid young people who believe there's no future for them in Africa trying to get into Europe and stay there, often illegally, to make some money by any means possible to be remitted to their families back home. What are the outlines? There's no state in Africa construed and demarcated to serve foreign appetites that can adequately provide for the requirements of its own citizens. African citizens are not only corrupt and inefficient and often alienated from their constituencies, but they also serve as intermediaries and purveyors of outside interest. The only striking power African armed forces have is to make war on the people. Power is the name of the game in town, and that is what interests the predators. The power, preferably entrenched, to access pomp and privilege and patronage and cronyism and state plundering. And impunity. Progress there may be in Africa, but no development that will last, no institutions to guarantee and protect us. Generations of young Africans have been brainwashed by Western gadgets made in China, often relying on scarce components extracted from Africa under miserable conditions, so that their imaginaire now consists of desires inculcated by this make-believe world of opulence and material security and ease. What are the further outlines? That the West, or the North, if you prefer, consider the rest of the world as their zones of influence, needed to fuel their economic and often, as with France and Germany, also their cultural well-being. That Western armed forces mandated, it was said, by European and American representational governments, intervened repeatedly to destroy old and nascent state entities. Syria and Iraq and Afghanistan and Libya come to mind, to divide and rule and maybe to share the spoils. That they had neither the understanding nor the resolve or the intention to contain the ensuing chaos. Wars are profitable too, provided it is other people far away who do the dying. That they helped engineer the establishment of a Jewish state, partly to disculpate themselves of guilt in having persecuted Jews over the centuries, and then in effect allow and abet that state to squeeze out of existence the Palestinians. How could Europe not have foreseen the consequences? Why is it unprepared for the tens of thousands of refugees exploited by human traffickers, feeding off their despair, who try to force their way into Europe? The lasting damage is that the West, Europe, America, intervene, disrupt, destroy and leave as long as they can secure the flow of petrol and gas in the name of democracy and human rights. How could they then expect these values not to be soiled? There have always been movements of people over the face of the earth, fleeing wars or dictatorships or famine or national disasters, to look for passages to new worlds, to conquer territories, to capture slaves and markets, to explore, to extend trade, to share the generosity of trying to understand and ameliorate the underdeveloped world, to experience a frisson of foreignness, to revitalize the jaded sentence. The nomadic instinct is part of our nature. History repeats itself, and it is not clear that we learn or even retain anything from experiences in the past. Perhaps we are doomed or programmed to play out the scenarios, more or less horrible, more or less utopian, built from the contradictions of our human condition. I'm the descendant of such a diaspora. My ancestors, at least from one of my father's side, and I write fathers in a plural form, left Europe either willingly or in despair, as far as I know from somewhere in Germany, to look for a future in what was later to become South Africa. The employees, adventurers, heretics, Glücksritter, fortune seekers, and riffraff in the service of the Dutch East India Company that established a halfway station on their route to the Far East at the southern tip of the continent, came from nearly every European kingdom and province at the time. Add to that, and thus add to my genetic pool, the craftsmen and the slaves and political or religious exiles proscribed to the Cape from company possessions in the East. Add to that the people who had always lived and moved over that part of the world as pastoralists and hunters, in tribal or clan or even national groupings that would soon be dislocated and decimated by the European intrusion of their space. Part of my ancestry also comes from them. In acculturation and hybridization, from processes of submission, dispossession, seduction, adaptation, becoming other, a new tribe was forged, the Afrikaners, meaning the descendants of the mixing of Europeans and indigenous people and slaves. Can there be any progress, survival even, without interpretation and enactment of power? Can there ever be justification for exercising power that is not posited on the recognition of so-called differences among groupings of people and thereby on the definition of the other? Can there be power that is not rooted in the fallacy of purity and superiority of race, doctrine, belief, intention, destiny, goal, or maybe even methods? Soon the history, the natural reality of intermarriage and survival and the usurpation of power would lead to the boundary of two new tribal formations, each with many internal variants. Afrikaners, as a lighter-skinned result of the mixing, and coloureds as darker-skinned Afrikaners. What they had in common, as shared vein of sameness and difference, was the coming about of a new language, a Creole tongue, Afrikaans. The rest of the history we know, of intrusion and exploration and conquest, acquisition and appropriation, of wars, frontier wars, wars with the Boers against British imperialism, and then the long struggle of black nationalism against those that were depicted as settlers, a struggle that would both admit to the complexity of liberation history and to the irreversible results of modernization or acculturation that had come about, and simultaneously deny and reject these. The struggle for state power, for territorial domination, was at stake. It was assumed that the rest, legitimacy, freedom, equality, perhaps even justice, would flow from liberation and the overthrow of the abominable apartheid regime. Black nationalism triumphed and did not find the antidote to the abuse of power or to the urge to monopolize control and patronage to the advantage of the cadres, the ruling predators, and their cronies. Like the whites, or the whitish nationalism of before, it enables skin color and cultural and linguistic differences to be the marker of belonging or not belonging, as to who will be citizen and who's subject, and ultimately to exclude the foreigner. The goal now is to legitimate a homogeneous nation that would marginalize and in due time expel the diverse and the different, ruled over and misruled by a faction within a majority alliance that still drapes itself in a tattered legitimacy of the struggle against injustice and for national liberation, and for whom the state is the boundless cave of Alibaba. The only question remaining is whether Alibaba is a pseudonym of the Gupta family or of the giggling President Zuma. And the result, for now at least, is that the demographic composition of the country, according to categories imposed by the white minority dispensation of the time, is used as a blunt tool to justify the hogging of power and to impose cultural cohesion. In practice, it means that in the name of Africanization, one language only, Globish, will be used and taught. It implies that we are expected to forego the vital and creative and enriching and transformative interactions between overarching goals on the one hand and regional or cultural diversity on the other. The National Democratic Revolution posits the disappearance of the Afrikaners as a distinctive result of bastardization. 2,000 years ago, Ovid commented thus on exile, I quote, "Beyond lies nothing but chillness, hostility, frozen waves of an ice-hard sea." And much later, Bob Dylan would take the thought further and remind us that in the end, we're all exiles, even the super rich who won't be taking any of it with them. Six, early in 1960, I came to Europe, not intending to stay, but also not knowing that it would be a very long time before I could go back home, and certainly unaware, perhaps, that there would never again be a home to go back to, just as one cannot return to the lost country of one's youth. I came as an African of the whitish Afrikaner variety. Much later, I would realize that my commitment to the struggle in South Africa against a barbarous system imposed by people of my tribe, none of which I regret and would not do again, was a futile attempt to help shape an environment where true transformation towards dignity and equal opportunities could take root, a home where the continued making each other different without prejudicing the outcome of the mutation, a sort of permanent revolution, therefore, would be the practice of the land. That was not going to happen. There was then no such place as Europe either that I could identify and be part of, even though, according to the classification then propagated in South Africa, I was considered to be a European. What did Europe evoke at the time? I was painfully aware of its exclusionary colonialist policies. After all, we were still in the middle of the Algerian War with its atrocities of torture and the OAS in France making its presence felt as a precursor to Islamist terrorist attacks in Paris many years later. African independence, in general, was still to be granted by the European powers to their client states. Salazar was still a big man in Portugal, where I first landed. The Caudillo Franco was haughtily alive and unrepentant in Spain and actively tolerated and supported by his Western allies. The Roman Catholic Church, in Spain at least, was, as before, stealing children from poor families at birth to sell them to richer, childless, devout, Falangist couples. Now, I can't remember that countries such as Spain, Portugal, and Greece would conceive of themselves as becoming part of Europe then. But already opposition by citizens all over Europe to the long and iniquitous Vietnam War was mobilizing and coalescing progressive forces. And the same would happen in support of campaigns for emancipation in Latin America. International and internationalist solidarity was a reality. Europe was in the making among people of all walks of life, aware of its besmirched history, certainly, but developing a collective purpose powerful enough to serve as a foil to American imperialism and Russian totalitarianism. Idealism and the acceptance of solidarity started being essential characteristics of a Europe in construction. This was not to be a compound of nationalisms and not just a common market, it was believed then, but the coming together on equal terms of a generation that had successfully slain the dragon of warfare between Germany and the rest to construct a Europe that could serve as example and resource for the poor embarking upon development, a Europe of values and of cultural creativeness, intensely aware of their relationship to the downtrodden all over the world, A Europe that would retain the specificities of textures making the component countries different from one another, whilst agreeing in an elan of trust and sharedness to abolish the borders and to harmonize human rights that would include the right to a dignified existence. A Europe that would not be dictated to by big capital. All of these generous battles for secularism, for the freedom of opinion and expression and movement, for an independent judiciary and strong civil societies expressing themselves inter alia in a vigorously independent and innovative media sector, culminated, symbolically at least, in the change of generations during the early summer months of 1968. And one could say, in retrospect, that this was the European Spring. Let me pause for a moment to spell out my reminiscence. And you must bear with me when I jump tone and perhaps space. After all, I'm not a politician. Let me pause for a moment. There's something about the human hand that seems to hold all of the contradictions of our existence, more so even than a heart, or in some traditions, the liver. It is a hand that caresses, soothes, creates, feeds, plants, gives. It is also the hand that holds a stone to be used as a weapon. It is the same hand as a fascist with the silver lettering on their black banners made clear on the screens of our living rooms that rests in a gesture of nearly tender reassurance on the shoulder or the neck of the victim, the fellow human arbitrarily chosen for execution before taking up the bloodied knife to cut off his head. It is also the hand that points, that writes, rubbing up against the words as if trying to ease its wounds, which will sign the treaties of good intentions that must estrange it. What happened to the humanist Europe of tolerance and hospitality? What became of the alternative to the American model, or to China's all-devouring and blithely unprincipled search for economic supremacy in the world? A fortress, a space, still nominally shared, where we see the resurgence of walls and barbed wire barriers. Of course, there is such a phenomenon as spatial recognition, which constitutes a communal sense of belonging, perhaps a possession, and of common destiny. The space will be physical, the landscape, the architecture, the climate, social and maybe historical, the laws and customs, the myths and what will be described as national interest, the story of statehood and particularly the language. How is the European conviction of belonging ever going to be threatened? It took the arrival of a few hundred thousand desperate migrants for the bubble of the much vaunted common purpose and tolerance to burst. Each country now seems to react in terms of its own interest or ignorance or callousness, and always with its own, and always with the demagoguery of populist posturing in mind. Measures were announced by bureaucrats and politicians who clearly were unimaginative and reactionary in their approach, even though they seemed to give only fitful and superficial attention to the question. Positions were not coordinated, or when decided upon jointly, not carried out. No wonder the border states felt that Schengen was not adequately protected. And along the way, Turkey was given the opportunity to blackmail Europe. And Europe came up with the humiliating solution of entering the trade in human flesh. For every migrant legally granted asylum, one illegal was to be sent back to Turkey. Two types of reaction are prevalent. The opportunistic discourse of playing the nationalist card, of barely disguised xenophobia. In most European states, popular perceptions regarding migrants are now defined by rightist parties and repression. How easy it turned out to be for bands of criminals of immigrant origin, the alienated results of a botched integration, committing acts of terror on their own or as part of a larger strategy to sow panic, provided they could pass this off as being done in the name of the prophet to disrupt Western societies. The Europe so many of us had dreamt about as means and method for the transformation in the concept of power and particularly of citizen participation and the accountability to the people of those elected to represent their interest, did not come about. What we have is a superstate gravely deficient in democracy. The old truth, which we also saw unfolding in South Africa and now ever more in the United States, became evident that you cannot brutally repress and exploit those who do not share your origins and your privileges without, in a distension of morals and the blunting of awareness, eventually destroying yourself. People have lost a sense of being able to inflect their own understanding and their destinies. The world has become too disjointed, too doomed for us to take part in. When we do, it will be mostly in folkloristic ways. We have been dispossessed of agency. In Europe, the rot is expressed in people whose salient attribute would now be that they are consumers. I buy without necessarily knowing where it comes from, or I scrounge for a living and therefore I am. Citizen concerns oscillating between purely repressive reactions and a politically correct spirit of the unengaged, or atrophied in a shell of narcissism where one can indulge in the freedom to be you, which seem to be channeled through the social media, a kind of a Facebook where the individual isolation is accentuated by the number of friends he or she has. This empowerment presented as empowerment of the individual, hungry for attention, for a sense of being. States now serve as mechanisms to reflect and promote the interests of the powerful. The European superstate, the compromise holding among nations as expressed through the organs of the Union, that is, among their politicians and coveys of unelected bureaucrats and experts and lobbyists, the decision makers without ethical depth but with a lot of nationalist posturing, is little more than a bulwark of liberal capitalism. The European Parliament might as well sit on Mars for all the proximity and accountability that it has to the European people. The consensus among the caste of technicians would still seem to be that progress, amassing riches, is infinite. There's a refusal to admit that this progress, spreading its tentacles over the world, is predicated on the growing impoverishment of the vast majority of people living on our planet, including here in Europe. The Greek crisis has already shown, and continues to do so, that the real interests of a market-driven Europe are strictly financial. It cannot be about the well-being of the people. Only profit matters. Europe will be remembered as a manufacturer of arms and a consumer of drugs, as a conveyor belt for Chinese junk, as the adjunct to those international instances truly and cynically embodying real power: Monsanto, Bayer and other pharmaceutical multinationals, Airbus, Volkswagen, the banks, Goldman Sachs, Facebook, Nestle. Allow me to allude to an illustration of the condition of being a migrant. It was given to me by someone who now finds himself in this nowhere, and quite appropriately, I don't know where the fable originated, and perhaps the person who gave it to me does not either, because there will be a total break between before and now, even though memories surface from time to time and are transformed in a process of recollection. The future or the beyond is unimaginable. This is how it was told to me. Everything is dark, so it seems. People are dressed in dark clothes, and it is as if their faces are black. We are herded together in huge, gloomy, derelict buildings. Those of us who were here first object to the new arrivals that also have to be accommodated, perhaps because we instinctively try to reconstitute a space of our own. It must be inherent to human nature. There are not many children among us, or maybe it is just that they are all so silent. More of us keep coming all the time. Hundreds must be lifted, must be fitted into houses that were meant for only 10 or most 15, or at most 15 people. One day we see a black cat climbing up a wall and disappearing through an opening into the roof. We pile furniture one on top of the other, and one of us, a migrant scrambled to the top to see where the cat went, how it managed to escape to freedom. He reports back that there's a space between the roof and the ceiling, and there must be at least 41 black cats up here, big and small, all mewing silently. In a corner of the huge communal shed where we are kept, there's a big black box. It is as big as a container on a ship, but square and without any opening or even a crack to let in daylight. It is also soundproof. From time to time, one of us will be summoned to spend time in a black box. This is an anomaly because there's no time in there either to be found or to leave behind. You cannot even see your hands. And if it weren't for the memory of the body, you wouldn't know that you still existed. Nobody knows how long you will stay in there. We don't know whether this is to prepare us for citizenship or to purge us of all memory of who we are or were and of where we came from. It cannot be meant as punishment because we know we've done nothing wrong. We do not know what to do with the corpses. We only remember that they ought to be washed and wrapped in clean cloth before inhumation or incineration, but we are no longer allowed the privilege of responsibility. Sometimes we are allowed out in the street. It is too painful to be there, though. We are blinded by the whiteness of the city. It brings back too many memories, flashes of war, landscapes we loved, rivers we crossed, the faces of people mewing soundlessly. These are the faraway pictures of death before life, or perhaps we are dead, and what surfaces now are of the life we so deeply buried under rubble and the distances of our endless wandering. Besides, we are not meant to remember who we were, where we came from. I remember that I opened a door, my beloved. You'd gone all gray, your head is trembling as if with the ache, as if you aged long before your time. You look at me and your lips move, but not to say anything. No, don't say anything. Perhaps it is better not to know. We no longer have a language to share. Then there could be resistance. We need not submit to the wipeout of historical memory, caused only too often by a surfeit of information with no guidelines to help us filter the really important from the white noise of communication. The human is an obsessive being, constantly duplicating his need to remain connected and informed. We can consciously and collectively work for a fair access to resources for all and the equitable distribution of means, or pay the price for disequilibrium, pressure, and contestation. We cannot pretend that the world is not one habitat. From Europe, we must look beyond our culture of seeing the rest of the world as either a source to enrich or enchant or horrify us, or as an underdeveloped but magical part of the planet that cannot and should not be expected to abide by the concepts we pretend to have developed. We must hold African elites responsible for selling out their aspirations and the hopes of their own populations. And from Africa, we need to face the schizophrenia of pretending to want to do away with everything that is not African, while benefiting from the protection and the ideals and the appetites and the expectations that, as people who have been in contact with the outside world and changed by that cohabitation, we all share. Perhaps we also need to realize effectively that there's no one truth, that we're all traveling together, that there's nothing, no fatwa, and no mirage caliphate, and no world system of domination, and no bank account, and no power, and no fundamentalism, and no fear worth killing for. This is not the first time Europe was invaded by the consequences of its policies. A few days ago, I came across the Museum of Exile in La Jonquera, on a border between Spain or Catalonia and France. I didn't know that it existed. The town is strung out in narrow strips along its main artery. It seems to be populated now by groups of swarthy young men all running dubious bars and tourist joints, and large numbers of prostitutes, mostly, it seems, of East European origin, and clutches of elderly women with kerchiefs from North Africa, I think, who while away the time together in the shade of the trees on public squares as they murmur their remembrances. In the last days of January 1939, 500,000 Catalans and other Republicans from Spain fleeing the national forces entered France. On the 28th of that month, the women, children, and wounded males were permitted to cross the border at La Jonquera. On the 8th of February, the defeated Republican troops were finally also allowed to cross. By the 9th, the 10th, and the 11th of February, the Falangists had taken control of all the possible crossing points. The refugees were taken to camps spread over southern France. These were not supposed to be concentration camps, but this is what they turned out to be, so that many of the migrants tried to get back into Spain. In the basement of the museum that reverberates with pain, with the horrors of indignity that man can inflict upon his fellow humans, there's a collection of drawings made by children in times of war. They are from Guatemala, El Salvador, Algeria, Western Sahara, South Africa, Spain, France, Germany, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Croatia, Kosovo, Chechnya, Lebanon, Palestine, Israel, Rwanda, Afghanistan, Japan, Vietnam, Cambodia. A book of these drawings, collected and annotated by Françoise and Alfred Brauner, is available. It's called I've Drawn Pictures of the War. It freezes the heart. From El Salvador, a child writes next to his drawing of six women beheaded by machetes. I quote, "Our brothers, don't kill us. Shut up, whores. You are guerrillas' wives. Our machetes have been sharpened for these women's throats." Or Juliette Braillon, 11 years old, from Paris, next to her drawing in the handwriting of a young child, I quote, "The planet is exploding. It'll be barren on the whole surface, but all around humans are flying, kicked out like a swarm of flies, but dead flies. While in heaven, heaven will remain, angels are moaning, oh God, what have men done?" In French it reads, "Oh, d'où j'ici, qu'on fait les humains." On the wall there are some quotes. One is a translation from a few lines of Goethe. "Victims slay, they hear, neither lamb nor steer, but the altars reek with human gore." And anonymously, somebody wrote, "El tiempo se acaba." Time stops. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Brighton. And I think to start with, I'd like to sort of circuit back through some of the lanes you took us through, and maybe start with this idea of the outsider looking in. Mm-hmm. Is that the inevitable and perhaps even necessary position of the writer? And in what sense are you the outsider? Are you outside mm-hmm. Africa or Europe? And given what you said in your talk, I wonder, is it even possible to be outside?
Well, the temptation, of course, is to generalize from one's own from one's own history and one's own condition. A number of years ago, I wrote an essay called Notes from the Middle World. In fact, that then came the title of a volume of essays, which was published in the United States, and the original essay was part of that collection. And in that essay, I tried to define for myself what is this notion of a middle world. And essentially, it meant that space, that in-between world, where you've left where you started from or where you originated from, for whatever reason, and perhaps with a destination in mind of where you will go and where you will fit in and where you will belong, but somehow never arriving there. Then I tried to... It's not quite the same as exile. It's not quite the same as cosmopolitan people. It's not quite the same as displaced people. All of these are people who, despite themselves, have been pushed away from where they were. Or in the case of cosmopolitanism, it was something that was used as a defense to fight the narrowness of the world. But the middle world originally for me meant the world of creative people, writers, philosophers, artists, filmmakers. And perhaps because it is something that is innate to the condition of the writer, or I use the writer in the collective or the generic sense of the person trying to transform the world, trying to form the self and to transform the world. I think there's always that duality involved in being a writer or being a person involved with creative work, because you're never sure of that I, that ego, that original source that you are in the process of defining. That is a changing entity as well. But you cannot help but see the world around you and wanting to be involved with it and wanting to try and do something about it, and sometimes more so, depending on history and where you come from, etc. And of course, then I grouped within that space a large number of people who are known to you. Hannah Arendt, for instance, or Bruno Schulz, or Franz Kafka. And then I went on, you know, you could talk of people even like Senghor, perhaps in his own way, Aimé Césaire. I suggested that maybe Mandela was a member of the middle world, at least for a while, before he became state president and reverted to the responsibilities of being part of the new dispensation. I also tried to identify a certain number of geographical places that would be part of the middle world, outcrops, as it were, islands very often, or Tangier in North Africa, or Alexandria in earlier times. In other words, places where the outsider or the middle worlder can live and be effective, or at least believed to be effective, but somehow it's a staging area. It's not really where you go finally. And then eventually the sense extended to ex-prisoners, to people coming out of institutions. This is not something that's only peculiar to artistic people, let's put it that way. I also tried to suggest that the condition of being in the middle world, of being as outsider, defines to some extent your interaction with notions of power, of authority, of hierarchy, of decency, of morals, and to, for that matter, of memory and of imagination. You have to remember who you were, and in the process of remembering, you know that you were remembering wrong, or you only remember some part. You project, and you probably try to create the utopia that you are projecting, but you know you'll never get there. And it, of course, also to a sense of identity, you know, because it remains an open question. I suggested that you cannot be born in that situation. In other words, the children of outsiders are not necessarily outsiders. It's another mechanism. It's another process that kicks in. But you probably cannot come out of it either once you're in there. In any case, so this notion of looking in grows from that very much. It is a comfortable place to be, of course, because it means that somehow you're not really involved with the nitty-gritty of either the place where you came from or the place that you were heading for. It can also be a way of protecting yourself against the world. For the moment, I can't really see it being any different. And I think it's something which is happening more and more. I noticed, I think we discussed a little bit earlier today, that in the Arab-speaking world at the moment, you have a resurgence of writers who are producing works, literary works, that are surrealist, that are future thrillers, that are all kinds of escapes, forms of escape from the reality around them, but it is born from a deep sense of despair of having not achieved what they thought was going to be achieved through the so-called Arab Spring. So I think this critical position, the one of being involved, of not being able to become disengaged, perhaps of becoming more acutely aware of the functionality of memory and of imagination and of language and of identity and of morals, of ethics particularly, and what power means, as I allude to here. And I think that is fairly common to what afflict us as writers.
And you mentioned that there are certain places in your imagination, at least, associated with this middle world. Is there any part of Europe that you would call the middle world, or Europe itself at all?
Well, I think Europe, again, of course, there's a lot of naivety involved on my side, to have imagined that it would create this thing that would surpass all previous rivalries and the dangerous differences that existed historically between nations. And somehow, as I try to say, that it would become a space of excellence, of generosity, of solidarity, of example to the rest of the world. Well, of course, that was terribly naive to do. I think Europe as it is now is a hodgepodge that really doesn't have any inherent reason for being together, except that it is very much to the advantage of the free circulation of capital, for instance, or to some extent the free circulation of workers. And that is not by means of saying that what Europe has achieved has not achieved a lot of things. Obviously, the doing away to a certain extent with internal borders, for instance, that is certainly a tremendous advance. I remember the time when you needed a visa to move from one country to the other, particularly as an outsider or somebody coming from another part of the world. And there are many others. I mean, there is a kind of a rough harmonization of social conditions to some extent, although it is also very uneven. The strikes that we have at the moment in France is essentially about the French, what's left of the French working class, and it's very much of a minority. At least the trade unions representing that working class are very much a minority, but very strongly trying to resist this notion that the kind of law practices, labor practices and labor laws that we would have in France should be dictated by Brussels, who is only concerned about lifting whatever restrictions there may be on profit-making by big international companies or by, for that matter, the capitalist class. So, obviously, Europe has not succeeded from that point of view at all. Are there parts of Europe which are more middle world, to call it that? I think Greece, for instance. Greece has been hanging on by its teeth. Personally, I don't think Greece or Spain or Portugal or Ireland should ever be in part of Europe. I think that what happened when they became part of the European Union was that they lost, in a sense, the very vital position that they occupied within their own environment, the Mediterranean environment, for instance, Spain to North Africa, or Portugal to Latin America, or for that matter to the colonies they used to have in Africa, and Greece certainly to its own neighborhood, to Egypt and to the Middle East, etc. And they all turned and they looked to Brussels for support, for allowances, for cheating as much money as they could out of the central fund, etc., etc. But even so, I think Greece, there's something coming through that for me feels very strongly as if there's a sense that they do not belong, that this is not their place, this is not where they ought to be. I'm not sure that there's a collective sense of where they want to be or where they want to go, but there certainly is a very strong sense of not being part of Europe. And therefore, yes, I think if you take into account what an ancient country it is, how deep the roots of democracy and of creativity run in that country, I think, yes, there's something approaching middle worldism there.
In a way, you would hope that that would resonate so deeply with what the idea of Europe is supposed to be, instead of being a sort of peripheral thing that, yeah. You know, is at risk and maybe leaving and maybe ending up in a worse case scenario than in Europe.
I think what we all struggle with is certainly we knew these things, because after all, as I tried to suggest there, it's not all that long ago where the marking characteristic of Europe, at least many people in Europe, and that included, for instance, the trade unions or the organizations of young people, students, and all kinds of associations of churches, etc., etc., in Europe active, a very strong sense of solidarity, of internationalism, of knowing what it is, what kind of a world they want to bring about. We certainly must remember that. And somehow, within a space of, what, 40 years, maybe, all of that seems to have faded altogether. We have now come to the point, as I read this morning in an American newspaper in America, which is now prevalent on the campuses there, and also very much prevalent on the campuses in South Africa, everything possible is done to shield off the people on those campuses from anything that may disturb them, that may come in from outside. Anything, any poverty, any residual injustice, that is not supposed to matter. You focus on the trivial, well, not entirely trivial, you know, the small little local battles in terms of whether there's enough of a minority represented at the university, whether the attitudes among males or females have changed sufficiently, etc., etc., whether people have overstepped the line. But certainly there's not a sense of being members or citizens of the world, of being part of the world. I'm talking to young people now. And even now, the young people marching on the streets of Paris and becoming involved in all kinds of street fights. I remember in 1968 when a cornerstone of what it was all about was internationalism. It was fueled by what was happening elsewhere in the world. There was a reaching out to the rest of the world. This is no longer the case at all. There's no talk about that. There's no sense of that at all. Nothing whatsoever. Nothing.
So interesting that you say that, though, because I have the sense that actually the narrative that's very much dominating a lot of the discourse, particularly in the mainstream media, is a narrative of insecurity coming from everywhere, is a narrative of not enough, of austerity.
Yeah.
And so there is a sense in which our connection to the outside world is constantly emphasized, but in a negative way.
Yeah.
And I think that people do have a sense of being connected, also because the world is so much more globalized.
That's true. Obviously, you know, it's like, so we wanted to have a global world. We have a global world, and now we can't stand what we see when you look at the global world, because now the global world actually wants to share. They want to come in, and they think as a philosopher from Cameroon, Achille Mbembe, in a recent book has said, the whole of the world belongs to all of us. By the way, he's very much quoted on South African campuses, him and somebody like Frantz Fanon, without people understanding a single word about what Frantz Fanon was all about. It is true, there's a prevalent sense as if we'd been undone, our means of being able to be responsible citizens taking charge of our own destiny seems to have been undermined. And we live in a fearful state of feeling threatened and of feeling victimized. In fact, what seems to be the most striking singular characteristics, if one travels through the world now, is there's a tremendous kind of a race for who is more victim than the other. We're all victims, you know, and I'm more victim than you are, or at least I will become a victim if I let you do what you want to do, etc., etc. It's awful. It is. I mean, it's certainly within my memory, and I'm not sure, again, as I tried to suggest early on, one has to be careful when you use yourself as a kind of a conduit, as a kind of a memory line, because you also know that you are modifying and you are cutting corners and you are adapting yourself to the realities as they arise. And of course it's a lot of projection and a lot of wishful thinking, but even so, I think I can make an objective case for the point that this is not where we were 40 years ago. This is not where Europe was 40 years ago. Now, one could say that Europe is not under the pressure that it is now. 40 years ago it perhaps wasn't the case.
Maybe. But I was also struck that you said that how you perceived Europe in the 60s, that it didn't seem likely that there would be this sense of a collective space. And to somebody like me, who's sort of grown up with the European Union in the background, very much in an indifferent way, because the British sort of connection to the European Union has always been ambivalent and fraught. but nevertheless, for me, it sort of seems self-evident that, of course, there would be a European Union. And so I was really struck by the sense that 40 years ago, it wasn't at all, you know, your feeling that these countries could find a way of, you know, coming together and rubbing along.
Well, I don't think, as far as I remember, that it didn't seem to be clearly thought out or clearly debated ideas as to where the limits of Europe would lie. For instance, it started off with a fairly small number of core countries, those who had been involved in fighting each other again and again, those in this part of the world where we are now, or France, or I suppose to some extent, you know, the Netherlands and Belgium and Italy and maybe Spain, et cetera, et cetera. That was the heartland of Europe, let's call it that. I mean, that is what needed to be done. And of course, there was shared history to a large extent. I mean, the negative one is there's a shared history of colonialism, you know, of going elsewhere and of colonizing other parts of the world. But there's also the shared history of development, of coming from the Dark Ages, for instance, coming from the Middle Ages, and ordering society to some extent, making it possible for people to develop to the best of their capabilities. There was a development in educational systems. There was a development in national health systems. There's a development in transport. You know, there's an effort made to make your cities look or to make them worthwhile living in, et cetera, et cetera. All of this was also quintessentially European. Not exclusively so, obviously, but I think these were part, for me, of what I would consider to be the values of being Europe.
And do you think they're not still the values?
I think they are. Well, now people are hanging on to these as if it's all under threat, you know, as if they're besieged, as if all of these, some are going to be taken over by the hordes of non-Europeans coming in and wanting to share in this. There's another question behind that, which I think I don't have the answer to, obviously, and I'm not sure whether anybody does. I think if we look at the world, there's a kind of a simultaneous development, let's call it that way. On the one hand, we have this ongoing attempts to try and shape it according to what we would probably agree would be ideals of conviviality and to some extent of ethical conduct and to some extent of representativity, in other words, of accountability, the kind of structures that we hope that would govern the places we live in, we hope would be held accountable by the people who put them there, etc. Although I believe that's not the case. I think very much this is not the case at the moment. I think if we could go back to city governments, we'd be far better off, even in the European context. By the way, I think that's one of the biggest contributions to Europe, of Europe to the world, the notion of a city government. And on the other hand, we have this huge world which is surviving and taking hold of the benefits of this advancement or this development, if they can get hold of it, of being profoundly influenced by it, of having their desires fueled by this. But the world that they are putting in place is nothing like the European world at all. It's a totally, to some extent, I think it corresponds maybe to more ancient forms of human organization, loyalty to clan, loyalty to tribe, loyalty to region to some extent. The paternalism, to give it that word, that would define it or that would demand that the strong would have to look after the weak, a sense of sharing. The notion of what is legal and not legal, that part of what Europe brought, that is totally left aside. People have built an alternative world, I think. And everything, and I think by the, you know, more and more, this alternative world is also here, of course, very much part of what we live here as well. And that world has nothing to do with legal passports and legal ways of traveling and legal ways of transferring money, or for that matter, a shared sense of the upkeep of hospitals or the shared sense of having some form of security or something like that. It's a total different fight for survival and to some extent grouping itself.
People living illegally within Europe, is that and traveling that, and moving?
And I think it is, well, it's very much the case in Africa. If you go to the mega cities in Africa, this is what you see. If you go to Lagos, if you go to Kinshasa, if you go to Abidjan for that matter, you know, or for that matter now if you go to Johannesburg, this is very much what you see. It's not as simple as you say it's Africa that's come to the West. It's not that at all. It's by the sheer weight of people who have not, for whom this is not what it's all about. And I'm not judging this at all. I'm not judging this because this other thing that they are not part of, that they do not want to be part of, is predicated on or is based on the notion of power and the notion of conquest and the notion of extending your influence at the expense of the other, because you can only become rich if the other remains poor or becomes even poorer. And that part is not necessarily part of what we see coming about. Now, I know I'm generalizing a hell of a lot, obviously, and I'm drawing very, very big and rough lines, because you'll find exceptions to this all along. But I do think the one, for me, the one salient factor that comes very much to the fore now is it is not just that the walls of Europe have been breached in terms of they cannot keep the people out, but they also can no longer apply successfully so the kind of norms that they think any kind of modern society ought to live by. And I think this is going to be an interesting thing to watch over the next, if there is a next number of decades.
What do you mean that they can't successfully apply the norms any society should live by?
Well, how are they going to succeed in this Herculean task of registering everybody that comes over, knowing where they come from, teaching them a European language, integrating them, giving them a passport, giving them a house, etc., etc. How is that going to happen?
If it's done in a controlled way, in a regulated way, if European countries accepted to take the quota, for example, that was set, it could be very manageable. I mean, certainly the numbers that were shouted.
It could be, but it will probably be at the price of Europe changing also. I think it would be at the price of profoundly modifying one's attitude to the rest of the world. That's what I tried to suggest early on, you know, this notion of the other, of this exotic other, or this other that needs to be pitied, or this other that needs to be helped, or this other that needs to be kept at a distance, or this other that needs to be exploited, because that's really what it has been all along through history. I think that has to change altogether. In other words, a collective togetherness. Yes, it can happen, but that's going to demand tremendous ethical and political awareness, consciousness, and leadership, and debate, and reflection, and that is not happening at the moment. I think what we see at the moment, we're seeing technocrats adapting, naviguer à vue, as we say in French. They are navigating according to the wind as it blows. They're trying to broach the breaches, for instance, or trying to stop the gaps. They're trying to stop it from getting out of control.
I do agree with you, and I think, I mean, you're right that absolutely the recent policies, the deal with Turkey, the kind of increased militarization of the Mediterranean, all these things speak to a very different way of dealing with the migrant situation. But I think it's also important to recognize that there's a very active civil society here in Germany responding to the situation in different ways and in very positive ways. And one other way of responding to the other, which is perhaps also a consequence of our sort of the kind of capitalist way we've been trained to think, but that these people, the utilitarian argument, that they can also contribute to our societies. Yeah. And so I don't think there's just always a looking at the other as someone to be exploited or feared.
Of course,
in the larger argument, when people talk about numbers, these things, in terms of very big numbers, these things come up. But I think there's also a different story, which is not just the story of.
I totally agree. I would think that is perhaps also different from one part of Europe to the other. For instance, there are certainly parts of Europe where migrant labor, to call it that, or itinerant labor, or people coming in, are exploited horribly. I mean, for instance, in Spain, again and again, people have to be reminded that you have to pay decent wages to the people actually picking the apples or doing your building or whatever the case may be. So there still is that kind of an innate sense of if it can be done, we'll try and do it. But at the same time, yes, I agree totally. As in Spain, for instance, you have fantastic, very active civil society organizations. For instance, the Endiñados, you know, or in Paris now, Nuit Debout. People coming from all kinds of backgrounds coming together and groping for some kind of a shared, maybe not a solution, maybe we need to move away from the conditioning that every problem has a solution somehow. Maybe we need to trust a little bit more the fact that the solution will probably evolve, if there is a solution, in a process of cohabitation or of getting to know one another, or intermarrying, as I suggested in the case of South Africa, which in the end did not work out, by the way, as I also tried to suggest. But at least I think there is a chance of that perhaps happening here. One can say that a lot of these concerns are the concerns of people who have the luxury of worrying about their souls, let's put it that way. I'm not being very crude. They want to live with themselves with a sense of decency. They want to feel that they're doing the right thing, and they often are doing the right thing. But do they really know what it's like to be on the other side of those who are being pitied or those who are being helped or something? Is it really the same thing? I'm not sure. I'm not sure that we have heard the stories yet of what it's like to be on the road, you know, some members of your family dying, drowning, your whole life being disrupted, and then coming into a place that you know nothing about. You don't know the language, you don't know the customs, etc., etc. And then somehow your life has been cut in two. Your life has been severed, totally so. There's a before and then there's now. And now how's that going to happen? And I'm not sure that we've yet taken the pulse. And that's part of what we have to deal with. I mean, this disjointed world that we live in, where there's these huge extremes between the privileged and the non-privileged, the underprivileged of those who didn't have it, and those who are now being killed. And they are being killed very often by arms that we produce them with. I mean, that is, if there's one thing that I want to bring over as strongly as possible, we need to know the consequences of what we are actually doing. I mean, on the one hand, yes, we're trying to do the good thing. On the one hand, we're giving money. On the one hand, you know, we are opening our centers, we're taking the kids into schools and things like that. On the other hand, we are raking in the money from the arms that are being produced and used in these countries to kill one another.
No, I mean, you're right, that there are these contradictions at the heart of Europe, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, right now, the TTIP, for example.
And that's what I mean by the deficit in democracy.
Yes, I mean, so how do we deal with that? I mean, we talked about leadership. We had a very strong gesture from Angela Merkel last summer, to a very humanitarian gesture, which had a backlash across Europe.
Yeah.
How do you perceive that? How is that regarded, for example, you know, in South Africa? Do people look and think what's going on in Europe, or is there?
Well, it depends, I suppose. I suppose it depends on who's doing the looking. In a case of South Africa, it's remarkable, I think, that Europe is not used as a reference in a South African story at the moment, neither by the whites, really, nor by the black people or the colored people or the Indian people. I think we are so consumed by what happens in the country itself, and there's a strong sense of being quite close to fulfilling one of the conditions, which was never clearly spelled out, but is becoming more clear now, of having a total monopolistic takeover by the majority government of the country. And that is a very sad thing to see happening, because that is denying the fact that this majority is, of course, also totally diverse in makeup for many parts of the country and of many cultural origins and of many languages, etc. But the binding factor seems to be black nationalism, which is very much strongly pushed at the moment. Now, I don't think that there's much of a looking to Europe. You'll know that, for instance, South Africa is part of BRICS, which is, of course, Brazil, which is India, which is Russia, which is China. I'm not quite sure what South Africa imagines it will do within that concert of very powerful nation, although Brazil, as we know, is not all that doing all that well either, and for that matter, Russia is probably not all that healthy either. But even so, there's a sense of Europe is not part of the horizon. There's a rejection, even to some extent, and to the extent that the whites or the whitish, descendants who live in the country are considered to be the descendants of Europe with European values, with European aspirations. They are rejected. Europe is rejected through them to a large extent. As for the whites, I don't think they look to Europe particularly. Of course, they like to think that they can come and visit, although they can't afford to do so. But they leave, and if they leave, they go to Canada, they go to Australia, they go to New Zealand. Some of them go to other parts of the continent, to other parts of Africa. I'm not sure that many people end up living in Europe. Individuals do, but then they've always done so.
South Africa's had a lot of refugees too from Zimbabwe. And I wondered if there was something about how that society dealt. It was a couple of million at one point, wasn't it? If you see parallels or perhaps some hope in how that was dealt with, that maybe can.
You mean in the case of Zimbabwe?
Yes.
Well, it's an utter disaster. What was dealt with, and I must say very clearly, when I mean disaster, I don't mean in the first instance a disaster of people having to leave the country or losing their possessions or losing their farms or whatever the case, or for that matter, the total failure of a dream of building a country together, of integration of some kind. The disaster I'm referring to is a disaster that's inflicted on the ordinary people still living in Zimbabwe, the people who could not survive if it hadn't been for United Nations or other agencies bringing food to Zimbabwe. The utter poverty, the utter misery of people in Zimbabwe to the extent that they have to leave and try and make their life in South Africa. Some people claim that now as many Zimbabweans living in South Africa as there are in Zimbabwe itself. So Zimbabwe, yes, Zimbabwe is the horror scenario from all points of view. And it's probably also the horror scenario for the people in power in South Africa as well, because I don't think we must imagine that the solidarity that existed functionally so, in a real sense, expressed by the rest of the continent to South Africa when our government, or to the people who became our government, the liberation movement, were in exile, that doesn't necessarily carry over to a return of a favor in the case of South Africa. The non-South African African is not very welcome in South Africa at all. I mean, we even have special words for them, etc. And that, again, I think can be explained because as the unemployment rate increases and as development does not happen and as people become more despairing of their condition, as they say more and more now, 25 years of independence and what have we gained from this? We are worse off now than we were before. In that environment, the poor African coming in from elsewhere, whether he comes from Ethiopia, whether he comes from the Ivory Coast, whether he comes from Senegal, you know, whether he comes from Zimbabwe or Angola or Mozambique, you know, he's immediately in competition for space and for vital survival with his fellow South Africans.
That's how some people in Europe feel, and that's how some of the narratives that we hear from certain populist parties goes too, that there's greater inequality in our society, the whole kind of capitalist system hasn't given us what it said it was going to, we are suffering hard times, and there isn't enough to go around, and so how can we also take in more people? I mean, besides the arguments that are sometimes put forward about this being a Christian continent and, you know, fear of Muslims coming. And I was very struck reading some of the pieces you've written about South Africa, that there are certain parallels about the transitions European society and South African society is going through. And I was especially moved by a piece you wrote for the Mail and Guardian in South Africa, The Future of Our Dreaming. Mm. And in that, you talk about how a society can be measured by the way it reacts to the foreigners in their midst.
That's true.
And you suggest that we need to keep dreaming of a better space. You say otherwise South Africa will self-destruct. And I think the same is true for Europe right now, that we need to keep dreaming and envisioning something to go towards.
I agree.
Because I don't see an alternative to the European Union.
I agree with you totally. I think it will not be done at the expense of a far much deeper and coordinated form of reflection as to what the implications are and what the real underlying values are. But of course, yes, I agree. You know, if there is something that runs like a golden thread right through Europe, right through all people's makeup, and certainly very much through the migrants, the refugees, the exiles, the people from the middle world and the others, it is exactly this notion of dreaming, this aspiration towards a better world, this aspiration towards a decent world where it'll be possible to live together, where children will go to school, old people will be looked after, etc., etc. And I think we have to cling to that. I think there's a lot of practical things that need to be worked out. I do not accept, for instance, this notion that Europe cannot absorb the people who are trying to come in. I'm not sure what it will ultimately mean. I think we need to distinguish very clearly between what I would call two large currents of migratory people. There are those coming from sub-Saharan Africa, and you see them in your news media all the time. I mean, you saw now the boats tipping over and the people drowning in the Mediterranean, young men very often, mostly, some women among them. But these are very often people who desperately try to get into Europe to make some kind of a living. That doesn't mean that they intend to stay there forever. In fact, this alternative world or this parallel world or the informal world that I was referring to is in the process of coming about. And it allows for people to move backward and forward, not in ways that you will expect or that you can control, but it happens anyway, it happens all the time. So you have those people, but with the exception maybe of people coming from the Sudan, and obviously from Burundi, and still a little bit from Rwanda and all that, or Mali, you cannot really say that these are people coming from war zones. These are people very often without any skills, with very little training. They're very young, very often, as you can see for yourself. And there are huge numbers. And I think how to deal, how to integrate, how to let them become part of whatever it is that they're hoping to become part of, that is one set of problems. The other one, the people coming from the Middle East, from real warfare, the Syrians and the Iraqis, and to some extent the Kurds, the Palestinians from before, the Afghans, to some extent as well. That's another story, because there you see whole families coming over. And very often these are people who are perfectly performing and solid citizens of any society. I mean, they're people with some training, with some skills. They may even be doctors or whatever the case may be, teachers, lawyers, et cetera, et cetera. That's another story altogether, whether they will ultimately want to remain and stay. If they do, I think it's a wonderful advantage for Europe. And I think Germany, strangely enough, is realizing that to a large extent. I think there's also a lot of practical opportunism involved. Europe, I mean, Germany is very old. Germany can absorb, perhaps progressively and perhaps effectively, and to its advantage, large numbers of people who will then become German in due time. I think there's enough room for that. Whether this is true of a country like Italy, or whether this is true of a country like Spain or Portugal, that's another story. One will have to look more clearly.
You, in your piece, you painted a rather bleak picture of the prospects for Africa in terms of the countries and economies there really becoming self-sufficient and overcoming the corruption that's so systemic. And so I was thinking about that in relation to the fact that right now Europe is negotiating this TTIP deal with America, and the CETA treaty with Canada is also has been signed, but now has to go through the various institutions at the European Union. And it's quite clear people who work on these treaties admit openly that they're going to be detrimental to trade with Africa, that there will be losses there. And I want to come back to these contradictions you talked about, because on the one hand, we have this fear of more people coming. On the other hand, our policies
makes it impossible for people
Kind of perpetuating the likelihood of them coming.
Sure.
And I really liked what you said in your piece, that we can't betray our values in one place and expect them to kind of,
exactly,
you know, stay watertight somewhere,
exactly,
else, that there's,
exactly,
there's this erosion going on.
Exactly.
And how, is it a question of leadership? You know, where,
yes,
is this kind of turn of thinking supposed to come from?
If I had an answer to that, I think I would get a medal from the Pan-Africanist organization. Because we've been dreaming about that also. You know, this is another thing that, if you get to be my age, and you look back...
I hope I do, at least.
No, I'm trying to suggest that with time, you do remember some things as you look back. And for instance, Pan-Africanism and African independence and African self-sufficiency and African dignity, emancipation, these were very much part of a national agenda or a continental agenda. People like Nkrumah, Salif Keita, people like even Lumumba, people like Thomas Sankara, Agostinho Neto, these people didn't come from nowhere. They were the fruits of a generation of dreaming and a generation of struggling. And there was a moment, I think, when those things were coming together. Where did it go wrong? How did it go wrong? Why is it so shallow? Why didn't it take root? I think partly because of a confusion between what was granted and what was won. Partly because of the national entities that came about and how these national entities came about. Partly because of the fact that maybe even then the outside powers, and mostly they were European then, now, of course, they're also Chinese, and even American, and to some extent Brazilian, because there's quite a presence there. But these outside powers were trying to retain the essential to a large extent. After all, Africa is also very rich in natural products, in resources, in minerals, in all kinds of things that Europe felt that it needed very badly. So it wanted to retain that. I think it was quite instinctive and natural that they promoted the coming to power or the staying in power of elites that were in fact representing the interest of these outside powers and more of the internationals than they were of the population itself. That is where something for me went wrong entirely. I find it utterly despicable that people who are the descendants of the liberators should have no concern at all for their own people in the country at all. It is an objective fact that in the case of even South Africa, the people are poorer now than they were 20 years, and that's a very recent event, than they were 20 years ago, that they live in more misery now than they did then. And that is the people who represent them, who were issued from that, who come from there, who were born in those places. They are the ones who are running the country, and they do so in the name of an ideology of generosity, of development, of sharing, of justice, and all of the things. How could you live with yourself under those circumstances? So for me, yes, civil society needs to be strengthened enormously. We need to do away with this false notion of demarcation of states in Africa, very much so, completely so. It doesn't serve any purpose except generate conflict from time to time between God knows, Nigeria and Niger and Chad.
I wondered if you think, I mean, considering what you as a citizen did, the risks you took to fight against something that you didn't believe in South Africa, against the apartheid system.
Yeah.
If you look at our European society and the way we're sort of going along with our current reality, and you think there's a kind of decadence in our lack of action, and that if in some sense we have to accept that the time for soft democracy, where the most we do is go and vote, is over, and this is the time of hard democracy, where maybe we have to do more. And I'm thinking in particular of an example I came across, that there are activists at the moment who are sort of really trying to make it easier for migrants to come to Europe. And they're doing that kind of against international law, not international law, but against national law, because the rights of people moving are protected in international law. So they're sort of almost doing what's illegal for a good cause. And I wonder what you think of what more citizens can do, how much more active should we be. And for example, regarding Merkel's deal with Turkey, which you talked about criticized, should we be out in the streets? Are you surprised that, more of a reaction?
Yes, I do think so, because it would seem to be the only thing that impresses European powers, the people in power in Europe, if people are out in the street. Well, I'm talking now from a French background. You know, and we used to say in France, there used to be this very, very rough definition that if you take away freedom of accountability or responsibility or action from the people in France, you have a revolution. If you do it in Germany, you have a dictatorship. I mean, you create a space where dictatorial tendencies will come to the surface. That, of course, is old history. It's not entirely true either. But I do think the only thing that seems to impress the people in power, after all, it's a very flimsy power that they have. Their power reposes on the fact that they have huge populations of qualified people, many of them also not having a job, but even so, they are fairly well qualified. They've been broken in to accept the kind of life that they lead, living until the age of 60 and then going to retirement and then perhaps getting an allowance from the state, et cetera, et cetera. It's very drab, it's very unimaginative, but that's a kind of, and of course their attention is being taken up entirely by marginal, by what in the old days used to be called perhaps bread and circuses, which is now your cell phone and your iPad and your television screen and whatever the case may be. But even so, I think the European powers can be moved towards greater responsibility if the people force them to do so. Now, how that should happen, I mean, it's quite interesting. For instance, now recently, over the last few weeks, this Nuit Debout movement, which started at the Place de la République, which is really a kind of an imitation of what happened in Spain, essentially, the Antiñados, where large numbers of people would congregate to a central part of the city and they would occupy it and they would have a live 24 hours a day debating forum, in actual fact. People would bring their concerns and they would dream together and they would scheme together and then they would perhaps start doing things together from there. In other words, it'll become a platform and it will start demonstrating, etc. And quite recently, the French authorities, even though they claim to be of the left, in other words, socialist, in other words, people who should be sympathetic to this kind of thing, the government sent in its troops to go and chase the people away from the Place de la République. So governments, people in power, and particularly big business, knows very well how easily they can be threatened and how easily they can be brought how easily can be forced to other insights. I don't think the battle is over. You can see it happening again and again. The Panama Papers, for instance, that came out recently, this outing of the dishonesty of the rich, the way they hoard away their money, the way they hide their money, etc., right across borders, etc. This is kind of the stuff that's within reach of people now with the new means, technological means, do I have to be able to go and look for it? But I think it needs to be far more coordinated, it needs to be far more continental, it needs to be far more international. For instance, there's a real need, not just the individual or small organizations of people helping migrants to try and come into Europe, although that's a wonderful thing that they want to do so, or to stop the boats from taking the people back to wherever they're supposed to come from, clinging to the anchor chains, et cetera, et cetera. That's a wonderful thing to see happening, and it sort of warms the heart. But there should be really coordinated and concerted efforts, I think, by far larger groupings of people, if they were to exist in Europe, to reach out and find a counterpart in these countries, in the other parts of the world, and then start thinking, what do we do together? I do think, I'm incorrigible, if I want to. Now you've talked me right around myself from being totally pessimistic to being totally utopian. And I do think it is possible to coordinate activity. I do think it is possible to dream. I do think the human being is capable of the better as he is also unfortunately capable of the worst. And I do think with some leadership, with far deeper reflection, with far more real pain, not the imagined pain of the victim, not the little person who doesn't want to be disturbed by bad news coming in, whatever the case be, but real pain, real sympathy, real empathy with the other, I think, yes, we can move forward.
I think we have a few minutes to take a couple of questions if any of you are really keen to ask something before we finish.
Es kommt. Ah, okay.
Breiten. I am very lucky because in an interview this coming Sunday, it's exactly 25 years ago, 5th of June 1991, you predicted, talking about your own country, nous allons bientôt explorer les variantes infinies de la barbarie. An extremely courageous remark you made. I gave you a copy, and I also gave a copy to our host. You were right to make... Of course. But if I understand you correctly, you fear that many parts of the world, maybe even including parts of Europe, will follow the, in a very negative sense, South African example. Did I understand you correctly?
Yes, I think.
Thank you so much.
I think the thing that what we never really cleared out sufficiently. Well, that is another long story, which is also a very personal one, and it's certainly the interpretation I give to it is also very personal. But I believe that we underestimated totally the shallowness of a real reflection within a liberation movement. A lot of it happened too easily. You know, there was a great moral investment by the rest of the world in the liberation movements all over the third world, or the so-called underdeveloped world, in a kind of an uncritical fashion. Now, we have to take ourselves back to those times. We're talking of the Cold War. We're talking of people taking sides. We're talking of Stalinism. We're talking of Maoism. We're talking of all of these things. The South African Liberation Movement, the ANC, benefited vastly from being supported, morally at least, and then to some extent also financially and in other ways economically, by citizens from all over the world. And people came to power in a kind of a haphazard, not a haphazard way, obviously. It was always very clear, although it's becoming more clear every day now, what the real motivation deeply embedded within the liberation movement was, and that is what I call black nationalism or African nationalism, or rather the tendency to exclude, and that's a desperate attempt, and it's doomed to failure, because you can only exclude and continue excluding those who are different from you again and again. We missed, in the case of South Africa, the most fantastic once-in-a-lifetime historical opportunity to make out of this incredibly hybridized country, to continue making out of this incredibly hybridized country something that would be enriched by the tensions, the need for justice, the agreement on central, overriding, overarching shared goals, such as economic upliftment, such as justice, such as no more capital punishment, such as no more racism, such as equal opportunities for everybody, such as good education. These are national objectives that we could have achieved. But deeply underlying all of that, if we'd kept alive, if we could succeed in keeping alive the national debate that needed to happen, looking at the past, looking really at the past, not trying to interpret it from whatever we wanted to be, you know, either from the white side or from the black side, whatever it is, but really looking at it deeply enough, really trying to understand it, really trying to understand why is it that we're also attached to this particular country? What is it that we have in common? But really also understanding that that which we do not have in common is an enrichment, enriches us, makes us go forward, makes us understand one another better, makes us listen to one another better. That if we lose even the smallest particle of that specificity, of that diversity, the totality loses. If we lose Afrikaans in the country, which is happening now, the whole of South Africa will suffer from it, even if they've never spoken Afrikaans. That's not the point. We are narrowing the horizon. We are narrowing down, we are codifying down to its basic shared common denominator, which is as low as you can possibly imagine it to be. Now, that is what we missed. And that's the kind of debate which one thought we had hoped was taking place within the liberation movement. The Freedom Charter, for instance. If we could live up to the Freedom Charter, that would already be something wonderful. Now, you have to go back and understand why is it that such a thing came about, and why was it only lip service? Why did people not really adhere to it? Why did it not become the policy-making document, for instance? Why was it never implemented? And I think then we have to go back again and again and again to colonization, to the fact of people living and working in a language which is not theirs, and perhaps living in a thought system which is not theirs, knowing how to use it perfectly well, but not really having appropriated it, not really deeply internalizing it, if that is the case, because the Freedom Charter is not an exterior or a document that was made outside. It's something that grew from within the people itself. It came from national conventions from in the country. So the barbarism was inevitable, because what you have in its place is people, an elite, cadres, who are hiding behind the fact that the old communist parlance of structuring of your labor movement or of your political liberation movement, where the cadres are the ones who have the good news, where you do not have personal representativity, where you do not have constituencies. It's a party that decides on what will be the list, the slate that will go to parliament, etc. But everything goes around power. The whole thing was around power. It was too attractive not to go that way. They could not withstand this incredible possibility of enriching themselves. They could also never understand that the state is common property, that it belongs to all of us, that it belongs to the people paying the taxes, belongs to the people working in the streets, belongs to the people producing the food, all of that. They never could do so. This is something we now talk of state capture. We talk of this Indian family, Gupta, who are now capturing state. But they're not the only ones. It's been happening again and again. And then it was accentuated, multiplied by all kinds of policies. The tendering, for instance, or the black economic empowerment or affirmative action, using the tools of the old apartheid regime to impose your own people. Nothing to do with competence, nothing to do with merit, nothing to do with formation. You had to reward your own militants, etc. So the whole thing multiplies itself. The whole thing is coming down. It now takes 4 or 5 years for a simple murder case to make its way through courts, if it does make its way through courts. I mean, the legal system has imploded. The educational system is giving way. The health system is giving way. The security system is giving way. And it's because there's no leadership. There's no real sense. There's no sense of responsibility. The people in power, the ministers of the ANC government, is not held accountable to the people. Not at all. They consider themselves to be victims of history. And as long as it keeps coming in, we have a minister going out to the farm workers, as happened a year and a half ago in a Western Cape. There was a strike of the farm workers, legitimately so, because they were striking about minimum wages and they were asking for a better deal. And they were striking against what was in effect still a slave system, because that's what's happening in the Western Cape. And they were out there and they went into all kinds of actions. There were some unions, farm workers were unionized to a certain extent. And of course, a lot of damage was done. Farms were burned down, vineyards were burned down, roads were blocked, some people died, etc., etc. The minister responsible comes and says, none of you will have to pay anything for the damage that was done. There's not going to be anybody held accountable. I agree totally with you. I think you won the battle. She spends more money in one of her overseas trips than any one of those workers will earn in a whole year. I find it indecent. I find it obscene. Yes, her name is Juma Peterson. I find it utterly complete obscene, because these are not stupid people. These are people who spend years in exile. These are people who see their counterparts in other parts of the world. These are people who travel through Africa. They know what it's like. They've seen what it's like. I find it utterly, completely irresponsible, obscene. Yes. Sorry. You need a...
have the privilege of the microphone. good evening. Thank you very much for this great evening. My name is Volker Riel. I work for a development agency called Miserior. It's a Catholic one, and I'm in charge for Africa. Brighton, you don't know me, but I know you a little from middle 70s to beginning of 80s, as I was then the member of a student group of Amnesty International, which was working for your release from South African jail. So I'm very happy that finally, after so many decades, we can meet here. We were maybe a little instrumental, I don't say. You were released because of our activities. I have a question on South Africa, as I'm also in charge of it. I lived the last 7 years in Zimbabwe as a development worker. I'm very happy about the attitude you have towards Zimbabwe and South Africa, you were saying here. Question, where do you see South Africa in 10 years? Do you think it might go the Malema way, the Mugabe way, the very destructive way the northern country has lived? Mm. Or do you think that democracy might then have its sense back in that country and that it goes a better way than it is going now? Thank you.
The holding mechanism, is it working? The holding mechanism that we have, or the holding entity that we have in the country, is of course the constitution. It is very much under pressure at the moment, and you can see how a faction of the party in power, because that's part of the answer I'd like to give you. One can see how a faction of the party in power is testing the limits of the constitution. For instance, the judiciary is quite independent. Now, there's a vacancy that's come up that will have to be filled. There's a commission that will be dominated by the party in power that will decide who's going to be the candidates for the post of constitutional judge. In practice, what it's meant so far is that the constitutional court has actually been defining the law. The laws have been there in terms of the constitution, but time and again it had to go all the way to the constitutional court to be given a contents, to be given legal precedence, for instance. And this is one thing I think they are very much, Jacob Zuma made a mistake in appointing the previous chief judges, Mugeng, whom he thought was somebody he could control, and it turned out to be somebody who could not control at all. Now, that kind of thing happens all the time. You have, there's a very vital struggle for power at the top in South Africa, which I think it's a wonderful thing, except that they get so involved in fighting one another that the little people are being downtrodden and are being misused or being manipulated by whatever faction wants to get to power. But the factions are starting to take a fairly clear outline. For instance, it seems to be fairly certain that the Communist Party is not going to be part of the ruling alliance for very much longer, which is a great conundrum for the Communist Party because it's never stood on its own. It never had to go to the polls, for instance. We have elections coming in August, municipal elections. They cannot field their own candidates. So what their legitimacy is going to be a difficult thing. I mean, for instance, the breakaway party, Communist Party, Alot Kusatu, led by people like Vavi, who was the previous Secretary General of Kusatu, that is not gelling, it's not taking shape. We would already be much further advanced in founding a counterweight to the abuses of power at the moment in the country if we had a strong alternative political structure to the left of those in power. For some other reason, it is not happening. They keep on dallying. They don't want to strike out and start a new party, whatever the case. Of course, people don't want to cut off from the purse strings of the central state either, because we must never forget that. You desperately want to get into a kind of a position where you can get money from the state. You want to be a councillor. You want to go to parliament. You know, you want to be given a tender by the government. The government is using that money, which it has plundered, the power that is plundered from the state, to use as patronage all the way right down. But more and more people are coming to a recognition. Now, let me be cynical. There's not enough for everybody to go around. There's going to be a fight for resources. There's going to be a fight for power. There's a struggle for power going on, and you see it happening actually quite acutely now in some instances. For instance, nearly all of the old guard of the ANC have become very critical, and that's not just Thabo Mbeki, who was pushed away by Jacob Zuma, but
people like Jay Naidoo, or people like Dennis Goldberg, you know, all of those people, they've come very strongly. They try to remain loyal because there's still that, very much of a historical loyalty. But I believe ultimately they will have to take the responsibility for saying far more strongly and far more effectively what it is that they're concerned about. For instance, recently there was a meeting of Mkhonto Wesizwe, that is the armed wing of the ANC. A dissident wing of Mkhonto Wesizwe met, and they were extremely critical of government policies. You know, I won't bother you with details, people don't know here, the whole Nakandla story, the Marikana story, and all of those scandals, one after the other. What will happen? What will happen? Whatever will happen, the minorities are going to get it in the neck. There's no doubt about that. They are the scapegoats. For instance, what's happening at the universities at the moment, that Afrikaans is being pushed out of, from all the campuses where it was still present in some form. University of Pretoria, University of the Free State, very much so now the University of Stellenbosch, etc., etc. It is not because it is a threat to the black students. On the contrary, it's not even that it's a threat. It doesn't even embody principles, but it is an unfinished job, as it were. It's an unfinished revolution. It's also the despair of going to the bitter end, as it were, of destruction, hoping that you will find something will arise from the ashes, something will correspond, something will stand up and arise and will be truly African, as if such a thing were ever to exist. It's no longer possible. It will no longer happen. Not in South Africa, not in those terms, not in any other part of Africa, for that matter, either. That's a big myth. It'll not happen. We have to think as ordinary, normal citizens of the world, with all our problems and all our possibilities and with our histories, etc. So whether the people at the top will ultimately split, whether that will open up a gap, because when a split happens, as it is happening now, more and more people have to revert us, I think, also to ideological differences, because they would have to justify why they're splitting. It can't be said, or it can't be known, that it is only about who gets the money. There must be some other deeper concerns there. And I think that is going to open up a space of debate, as it is already doing, which may be very interesting. And the best hope that's coming from that point of view are the young black intellectuals, journalists, essayists, and others, writers, who are doing fantastic work in the media to the extent that the media still is allowed to exist freely. And that's not very much either, because the South African Broadcasting Corporation is totally controlled by the people in power to the extent that they've now made a decision that they will no longer show the unrest in the country because it's bad news. It gives people bad feelings about the country. It gives them bad hope about the country. So they're fighting. There are people in there. And if you dig a little bit and you start looking at the writing coming out, the essays coming out, the articles coming out, the books coming out, read a book by Ferial Hafaji, What Would South Africa Be Like If There Were No Whites, for instance. Or read a book about Tiens Eloff, you know, about the future of South Africa. Or read a book, the new book of Muletsi Mbeki, the brother of Thabo Mbeki. Or Justice Malala, read his book, for instance. Fantastic, these things coming out. The debate is there. How to bring it across now to the point where it would get people, enough people to adhere to it. Because, of course, there is a sense of everybody thinks that they're involved because they can write an email or they can do something on the social media. You know, that is a way of destroying involvement. That's not a way of becoming involved at all. So it'll have to be done far more deeply and far more cohesively. But whatever happens, I'm afraid, this discourse that I'm trying to defend of, I don't like the word diversity too much, but let's say keeping alive the possibility of multiplicity, multiple identities, multiple languages, living between languages, enriching yourself, paying homage to the real roots, being enriched by the shared roots, each in his own way, in his own very specific way, that does not count. It's not getting any traction at all, including and specifically not from the white community leaders who are supposed to defend this kind of position that I'm taking. I'm talking now of the people teaching at universities. I'm talking of the vice rector of the University of Stellenbosch, or for that matter, Free State or Potchefstroom or Johannesburg. So they are out. You can make a big cross about that. That's gone. Some remnants, some memory will survive, because the country is far more hybridized than just the fact of there being minorities. Far more so. In all points of view, it's never going to revert to, or it's never going to be whatever Zimbabwe became. I don't think so. But there's going to be a hell of a lot of very, very serious strife before we get there. Luckily, the army is not involved. The police are very much involved. Our spying agencies are very much involved. The Stasi must be rubbing its knuckles. All those people they trained with such great care, Bulgaria and in Moscow and here in East Berlin. Now, finally, they are there in their positions of power. They are there, yes. We're using all of these state resources of security to fight the internal battles and to fight one another. Okay, Susan, and then Hans-Christoph. Sorry, Hans-Christoph.
Sorry. Globalization has been with us for quite some time, and it has come in two ways. It has come, you see, from the metropolis, I mean, to the periphery. It actually has also come from the periphery, I mean, to the metropolis, which I think is, I mean, really happened, you see, in the 60s specifically. Now, I have the impression at the moment, you see, that people, when they talk about globalization, can only imagine it can come, you see, from the Washington consensus or the Silicon Valley consensus. It can always actually only come from the West or the North to the South, not the other way around. But of course, it has never been like that. Mm. I mean, I remember when I went to Lesotho, I mean, I actually came across Lekgotla La Bafo, a group that actually was protesting against, you see, the British, who actually maintained, you see, the council system that people actually had, but restricted, I mean, to the royalty. And so Lekgotla La Bafo actually said, now we want to have the council, you see, of the commoners. And at the same time, they were actually registering everything in the world. I mean, from the IWW in the States to the revolution, you see, in Moscow, and the Marcus Garvey movement, you see, in the West Indies. I mean, that was actually just astounding. I mean, how sort of, I mean, globalized is the perception was, even by people, I mean, who were rooted, you see, in a local thing. So, I mean, my question really is, can that globalization that came, you see, I mean, from the periphery, I mean, to the metropolis, can it have been completely gone? And is it something, you see, that can actually come back?
Hmm. One second.
And sort of re-emerge.
We might just pick up one or two other questions as a final round, and then.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I saw a lot of hands raised.
I'll just try and come back to that, and then we get to remark.
Thank you, Breton. I want to ask you to imagine a little bit what a deep looking at the past that you said didn't take place in South Africa might look like. It's something that I've been working on lately, spending a lot of time in Mississippi, where they're doing quite incredible work, and without, of course, all that much knowledge, although they have some contacts to South Africa, they see South Africa as a model. There's even a largish organization called STAR, Southern Truth and Reconciliation. And clearly, there's a process that you're imagining that didn't take place, though there was sort of window dressing. I just I want to know what you imagine would be a true looking at the past.
Hans, there it is.
It's frustrating to add something after all these things which have been said, but the way you describe South Africa today reminds me of Roi Ubu by Alfred Jarry.
Very much.
And
so.
Since I've lived in Haiti for a long time, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
We had a personal experience like that when we visited Thomas Sankara, one of the few good guys in Africa at the time. And shortly after we left, he was not only ousted but killed by his successor, Blaise Compaoré, in Burkina. Yeah. And Blaise Compaoré sent me a fax. There were no emails at the time. And to you too, I think, that we would be welcome. Please come back. Nothing happened.
Exactly.
So this is Le Roi est mort, vive le Roi, etc. How do you cope with all that?
Yeah.
And now that's a very practical question. What do you do? Where you live? Do you paint? Do you write? Do you write poems?
I do.
What do you do?
I do. I'm not sure. It partly addresses what Susan was talking about too. I'm not sure. My own experience now, my own personal experience, of course, yes, I continue painting and I continue writing even more and more so in a kind of a desperate attempt to, to not go silently into that dark night, as Dylan Thomas said, to keep alive the sense of what I call agency or hope or involvement or worth. Or even if it's not for the future, then at least for the past, let's at least be true to where we come from, or at least what we believed in and what we did. And that's why I sneaked a little line into what I tried to convey tonight, saying that I do not regret anything or any way or any action that I was involved in trying to fight the regime at that particular time. Of course, now looking back, I would say, how could I have been so stupid not to have seen this? How could I have not expected this to happen? And it is very distressing. It is very discouraging. This Ubu-esque behavior, what I call the distension of morals, the distension of the acceptable, how you can extend it more and more. You know, and in many ways, this extension of the acceptable happened perhaps without one looking and without one being able to do about it. I'm talking of the AIDS epidemic, for instance, in Sierra Leone and in that part of the world. That you cannot lay that. That's not a political responsibility. But the fact of death, the fact of starvation, the fact of displacement, the fact of people tipping overboard in the Mediterranean. These images are also seen in Africa. The devaluation of the individual life, you know, that kind of thing. What happened in Marikana, for instance, the shooting of striking workers by government forces in a pay of Lonmin from London, and with our vice president being one of the big boys within the Lonmin makeup, I'm talking of Cyril Ramaphosa, who's supposed to save the country, et cetera, et cetera. The callousness with which has happened, it extends. It makes the unthinkable acceptable for a larger and larger number of people. And that is, I think, that one fights against. And of course, it's a personal fight also. It's also, how do you get up in the morning, you know, and what is it then that you hold to? What is it then that you cherish? What's it that you still believe it's worthwhile, you know, putting on a pair of trousers and facing the day and doing something about that? Now, I look at myself and I notice that I'm getting more and more hysterical as I go forward. You know, I become involved in actions or in fights that have people that I'm in fight with, for instance, as companions whom I don't know from anywhere. I have no idea where they come from. I'm not even sure that we talk about the same thing or that we're fighting for the same cause or something like that. And of course, it is horrible to feel that whereas you once thought, perhaps mistakenly, that you were being part of the main blood course that went into the country, feeding the future, our future, all of us, our future. And now you find yourself sidelined. You know, you're not, I mean, there's no juice at all. You have no influence. Writers have far less influence than they used to have under the previous regime. That's, by the way, one of the things that happened immediately after the coming to power. You know, say, okay, now we've won this battle now. Now you can be quiet. You can, you know, we draw you into government, as it were. We're going to create national cohesiveness. That's the word. Even now still, this debate around universities is being justified by the ANC as promoting national cohesiveness. And what they mean by national cohesiveness is
you know, the lowest common denominator, the rubbing out of diversity, the rubbing out of originality, the rubbing out of memory, the rubbing out of imagination. So what is it that one would like to see happen? What's it that one would want to see? Well, as I'm sure, you know, again, many people have been there many times. I mean, I whine because it happens in my lifetime that my language is disappearing, for instance. You know, and that my people are scattered all over the world. That's all gone. The comradeship is gone, all of that kind of stuff. But it's happened in many parts of the world again and again and again. And that's why I was suggesting perhaps it is so that we're building scenarios, part utopian, part absolute horror, and that is probably part of human condition. That is perhaps the way we are. Because, for instance, when you talk about the assassination of Sankara and of Kampaore coming to power, which he did, and he ran that country as a dictator for many, many years to come, well, ultimately, he was overthrown. Ultimately, he had to leave. He's not a poor man. He's living in Ivory Coast. But I would not be so safe if I were him. Look what's happening to Assin Abré now, yesterday. Assin Abré was condemned to a life service, life sentence, for what he did 40 years ago, I think it is something now, in Chad, you know, the people he killed then. So it's not a matter of passive fatalism, that what comes round will come round. It's not that, because I would like to believe that we have some thread of memory that makes it possible for us not to go to the worst of where we were before. Let's hope so. Let's hope so. I'm not even 100% sure about that anymore, but let's hope so. For instance, let us hope that in the case of South Africa, we will not get to the point of mass capital punishment again, because that was just used by the previous regime to eliminate people, you know, to eliminate political opponents, in effect. Or for that matter, let's hope that we will not go the road of political prisoners again. And that's not entirely true either, because people are being assassinated. Political opponents are being assassinated. It's not reached a big level yet, but that is already happening. And torture does happen. Torture does happen in the police stations and in the prison cells and things like that all the time. So we haven't got that one fixed yet. But we have, for instance, somebody like Mrs. Madonsela, our, you know, defender of the people, who did a fantastic job. Now she's come to the end of her time. She's going to be replaced by a flunky, by somebody who's going to be protecting Zuma. Zuma couldn't care a damn about the South African state or about the people. For him, it's a private business, and him and his family are getting rich hand over fist or something like that. So he will make sure that the next person will not be a mistake again. But at least the fact that she existed and what she did and what she stood for, and she's going to write about that, that is really something I think that we need to valorize and we need to remember. So with very faulty means, and with a lot of heartache and something like that, I do think, yes, you know, we need to, as Beckett said, you know, I can't go on, I must go on.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here and for being such a good audience. You can maybe speak German outside if you would like to join for a drink or something. Okay, good evening, everyone.